Today is June 27th, 2021. My name is Anne Shi. I'm an associate curator at the Houston Asian American Archive at Rice University. Today, we're taking an oral history interview with Xuan-Hui Ng, who is currently dialing in from Tokyo, Japan, for her oral history documentary. It's 7 a.m. Tokyo time, so we're really appreciative. Thank you so much, Xuan, for joining us.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, you're very welcome. And starting from the very beginning of your story, can you tell us when, once upon a time, where were you born?
I was born in Singapore and raised there until I went to college in the United States at MIT.
Can you tell us a little bit about your family, how they came to Singapore?
Right. My dad was originally from China. He was born there. And I think it was, and the family moved to Singapore when he was very, very young. My mother was a second generation Singaporean. So her father was born in China. Her mother was an Indonesian Chinese. So both my parents are essentially immigrants from China.
And can you tell us a little bit about your name, Xuan-Hui Ng?
My dad is a Teochew, so that's from a certain part in China, from the southern part of China, and they speak with a dialect there. And in his dialect, the surname is pronounced as "ng," but in Mandarin, if we go with the Chinese pinyin, which is the standard way of spelling or pronouncing Chinese names, it's supposed to be Huang, so H-U-A-N-G instead of just N-G. So that's caused a bit of confusion, especially to native Chinese, as well as to Hong Kongers, because they think it's a different character. My name, Xuan-Hui, is spelt in the funny pinyin way. So that furthers the confusion because there is a mixture of dialect as well as the standard Chinese spelling in my name. Xuan means profound in Mandarin, and Hui means intelligent in Mandarin. So I was told that the parents usually name their children after what they hope their children will inherit in terms of characteristics from the name. And so that was how I was named.
And can you tell us a little bit about the family values that your parents brought you up with?
My dad was always busy when I was young. So my mom was handed most of my, I guess, education. and she told me, I think what she believes in is hard work and also learning. So to keep learning, even when you're old, you should continue learning. So, and that education, once it's acquired, it belongs to you forever. And that's something that no one can take away from you. So that's something that has really stayed with me, even though she has passed away for over 20 years. My dad, although he's not often at home, I think that what I really remember from him is also hard work. I think that's one of the key values that I learned from him, or should I say that I see in him, because he worked really hard. And I remember on weekends, after dinner, he would try to take us out once a week for dinner. So usually it's on a Saturday. And after dinner, he used to run a bus company. He would take us on a car ride and basically go around to see how the buses are operating. So we will be like patrolling, following behind the buses to see if his bus drivers are driving too quickly, if they are violating any traffic rules. So that's something that sticks in my mind to this very day.
And what are some of the childhood food that you grew up eating? Like, is it multi or?
My family is from southern China, like both sides. My mom is Hokkien, so she belongs to a different dialect. But she spoke Cantonese as well. And so I think our food was mainly Chinese based when we're eating at home. But when I was in school, Singapore is multicultural, multiracial. So I get to eat Malay food, Indian food. And for me, that's really exciting because it's different from what I eat at home. Food at school used to be so cheap. So it was like probably under 50 cents in US in US terms. Actually, probably about like 30 cents in US dollars. So it was very delicious and it was just great. Lots of local food, basically.
So, would your parents, one of them, usually cook, or would it be your grandparents cooking?
We lived away from my grandparents, so my mother would usually be the one who cooked. But I learned from my dad that she did not know how to cook when she first married my dad. So my dad had to teach her how to boil water, and that's how she started. But she learned from cookbooks, and so I was surprised when I learned later, when I was older, that she didn't know how to cook when she first got married, because to me it was always so delicious. And she would do that. She would cook after she returned from work. She was a teacher. She was teaching in high school and teaching Mandarin.
So, how many languages did you grow up speaking?
I spoke Cantonese with my mother and English, some English with my dad, and Mandarin in school. That's when I learned it. Although my mom was a Mandarin teacher, I didn't learn to speak Mandarin until I got to school.
Yeah, I was
And
just amazed how many languages you speak.
and so it was these three languages. I think Cantonese, I watched a lot of TV series from Hong Kong when I was growing up, and my mom loved watching TV too. So we would both watch these TV series. And so I think that's what helped me with my Cantonese growing up. Japanese was something that I learned when I was when I started learning in college. I wish I had started learning earlier because I did realize that the accent is something that is much easier to acquire if you start learning younger. So if I had the chance to reverse time, that's what I would do.
And also, I'm curious with what kind of memories of your birthplace, which is Singapore, that got really imprinted in your mind up till now. Like, what kind of childhood games you play, or were there any significantly impactful memory that kind of shaped your future?
I think school was really fun, playing in school. And I don't know why, but the other day I was just thinking of this game that we played during recess, so during lunch breaks. And it was just like jumping around. But for some reason, some of these games that I played still, I think of them like randomly every now and then. I think looking back, I wish I had spent more time enjoying school rather than being more studious. So, yeah, I childhood was fun.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And what is the kind of diversity like in your school, given Singapore is also very multicultural and multi-ethnic place?
Yeah, I think my exposure to, I think my, sorry, my primary school and secondary school, that's how we call it in Singapore. I think most of my classmates were Chinese. That as I moved on, perhaps it's the nature of my school, but when I moved on to secondary school, which is, and later to junior college or high school, as you call it in the States, that's when I started getting friends from different races. But I am embarrassed to say that my understanding started much later. And I had to be educated, or I had to educate myself. And I'm really bad at festivals. So, and as you know, Singapore, like for me as a kid, the festivals of the different, like whether it's races or religion, to me, it's just holiday. I was like, yay, another day off from school. But I wish I had learned more. And so that's something I do, like when there is a festival these days, I would actually have to look up on Wikipedia to learn more about it, to re-educate or to educate myself anew. But yeah, I think as I got out of school and started working, and that's when my exposure got greater. I remember when, in fact, when I was working in Hong Kong, the majority of my vice presidents, the VPs at the investment bank that I worked at were from India. So it was a very interesting combination to actually start working with people of different races. Mm-hmm. They were most intelligent, IT graduates. I was really amazed by how we got to work together. Mm-hmm. And I think the amazement or the surprise was due to ignorance on my part. And in college, when I attended college at MIT, that's when I got to see the other races in the States as well. I mean, there are not that many white people in Singapore. Or like and Black people as well. And of course, Hispanics and the minorities in the States. It was an entirely new world to me. It was actually really fun because I'm learning both economics, which is what I majored in at MIT, as well as learning more about the people around me.
Was there any cultural shock when you first arrived in the US?
Well, less than I thought, perhaps because I was expecting different, a world that would be very different from mine. So I think I was mentally prepared for it, but I didn't feel uncomfortable. I think that's one thing. I have traveled with my family before, so to me it was just, oh, this is exploring a different culture. So that wasn't really much of a culture shock. I think that was more a culture shock when I came to Japan or when I started traveling to some other places when I got older. But in school, I felt it was still quite a safe environment in terms of like everyone was just there, perhaps because we had a common objective, which was to study and have fun. And so I didn't really feel the difference or any forms of shock at that point in time. But perhaps I was just unaware. That could be it too.
Did you have any mentor that significantly impacted your decision to go abroad to the US and study?
No, but I think my family had my parents had always wanted me to be exposed to life abroad, overseas. My mother, she had to fight for her right to be educated in a university. I think in her days, men or like males were more highly valued than females. And although her family was relatively well-to-do and she could go to university, she could not go abroad to study, even though she had the qualifications. So I think she had always wanted me to go abroad. And from my dad's perspective, he did have a chance to go on an exchange program when he was a student, and he spent some time in Santa Fe with a, sorry, not Santa Fe, San Jose in California with a host family. And that's when he took up sailing. He was a Boy Scout, too. So for different reasons, but both my parents wanted me to study abroad and to live abroad and to be exposed to different cultures, different people, and a different set of education. So I think they were the biggest influence of mine to apply to for college in the States.
And speaking of your two major careers in investment banking and in art, like what was some of the kind of the forces that pull you towards either? Like, why did you study economics in MIT? And like, what was the first encounter of arts in your life? And how did that came about?
You know, in Singapore, we follow the British education system. So I took my A-levels for a qualification into college. And my weakest subject was economics. I don't know why, but for some reason, that's what I decided to major in. I think because mathematics was my strongest subject, but I did realize that I wasn't a math genius, that I wanted to do something that utilized mathematics, but also had the qualitative element to it. And so I thought economics was a good combination of both. And I know that in UK, there was more, or that was my impression that it would be more qualitative, but in the States, economics would be slightly more quantitative. So that's the reason for opting to study economics in the States. My first job was actually as a research assistant at the IMF. And so that's continuing along the lines of economics. But there were some changes in my life at that time. My mother passed away during my first year of work, and I had to fly back. So I thought I wanted to be closer to Asia instead of continuing on the career path of a research assistant by going back to graduate school. So I decided to leave the IMF and head back to Asia. The reason for selecting investment banking is actually quite a trivial one. The reason is one of my best friends, my best college buddies from the States, had gone to work in Hong Kong at JP Morgan, the investment bank, and she seemed to be having so much fun. And so I thought, well, investment banking seems similar enough to economics, or at least in terms of the required training, or so I thought. And I thought Hong Kong would be a great place to live in for a while. So I started applying to investment banks in Hong Kong, as well as in Singapore. And it turned out to be different from what I expected, but it was very challenging, but as well as very fun at that time, because we had a very good set of, I had a very good set of colleagues. So we worked hard together and we played very hard together as well. The switch to photography came about after many years later, and I had been working in the field of finance, a bit in and out. I think I began to realize that investment banking for me as a long-term career was just not very suited to my personality as well as to my long-term interests. I took up photography about 10 years ago, and I realized at a certain point about for like five, six years ago that I cannot manage both as well as I want. And that if I want to improve in my photography, I would have to leave investment banking. So that was a choice that I had to make. And I made it to leave banking. I think the mentality, because I photograph landscapes in nature, and the frame of mind that I was in when working as an investment banker was just very, very different. I had to be constantly checking my BlackBerry at that time for work. Any responses that I, any emails from clients, I had to respond immediately. I felt that I should respond immediately. So I remember vividly this experience when I was taking 2 weeks off in Mongolia, but I had work to do. So every time we went close to a cell tower and I thought I had signal, I would be checking my email and trying to receive incoming messages. And when we didn't have cell tower contact, I would be typing responses to my clients or to my colleagues, and then waiting for the next opportunity to send them out when we are close to the next cell tower. So it's that constant state of being, I think the mind had to be constantly active. And so it was different to balance that with nature photography, where I needed to spend time to soak in nature and enjoy the surrounding and be able to see. There was a point in time when I was so tired from work that I just couldn't see, or I couldn't create the images. So, and that was when I realized that I had to pick one or the other.
I'm not sure if you cover this, but would you mind elaborating on how art like initially come into your life? Was that during college or like earlier or childhood?
Childhood, my first experiences with art were not pleasant. My mom tried to make me to do like cross stitch, crochet. And we had art classes where we had to paint, and I didn't like the fact that we had to, that it was so precise, and my hands were not very good at crocheting. So my mom would like hit my fingers every time I get it wrong. So knitting I was fine, but crocheting, I just couldn't do it. So I really didn't like it. I fell in love with art, or the notion of art, when I was picking posters for my college dorm room. So I think I was in JCPenney's, so at the poster shop, and I was just flipping through the posters, and I came across Monet's Sunrise. And then I went, oh, that was just beautiful. And so my first poster, my first dorm room poster, was Monet. The next one was Renoir. I didn't know who these people were, but once I found the piece of art on the poster, I started looking up the web to see who they were and to learn more about them. And so one thing led to the next. So there was like Degas and then Chagall. So that was my first real exposure to the art world, to painters. I took up photography after a trip. I was in between jobs. So this is jumping a number of years forward to when I was in between jobs. I think I just left JP Morgan. Sorry, let me think again. No, I left another bank. And I was in between jobs and I decided to go to Tibet for a trip. The reason for taking that trip and for that break from work was my mom passed away right after, like the first year of work after college. But I think the way I dealt with it was to suppress my memories of her, my sadness. And I think because I just didn't want to deal with it. I remember within 2 weeks of her funeral, within a week or 10 days, I was back in the States because I just wanted to run away from it all. And that was how I dealt with the death of my mother. And so I think it was never quite resolved, at least emotionally for me. I just buried it, my emotions. And then I had a very bad breakup. I think that was about 6 years later after her death. And then I think it was accumulation of these factors. So I was in a very bad spot at that time. And like probably 4 or 5 years. And then after that, I reached a point where I realized that I needed to move on. I need to pick myself up. I need to stop feeling sorry for myself. Because I think at that time, it was just about me, about the sadness that consumed me. So I realized I needed to do something about it. And I thought I would go on a trip to Tibet it was working at the orphanage. For about a month or two, sorry, for 2 months. And during that time, we would get to travel around Tibet as well as a group. So this organization was based in the States and I signed up for it. And I went with a group of young people like myself to go travel as well as to not work, but just to help out at the orphanage. And I think that's when I started changing, I felt. And that was also where I found peace when I was sitting by Lake Namsul, this highly elevated lake in Tibet. It was just so peaceful and calm. And for the first time, I felt that all the unhappiness, the sadness were just being pushed out by the beauty of nature. So, and that sense of relief was good enough for me to make me realize that it was possible. And that was where I realized that life was beautiful as this monk, this meditation specialist actually once said to me, and that was life is beautiful. And I think it was there that I realized that life, that nature is so beautiful, that there are just so many amazing sights that I need to explore and to live for and to enjoy. And that's when things started changing. And looking back at images, pictures from that trip, so some of my friends or the friends that I made took pictures of me playing with the orphans, and I was really laughing. And so I realized that happiness was possible again. And I realized that like 1 or 2 years later, I bought a camera and took up photography lessons online. So that was my first exposure. I didn't know what an f-stop was. I had only the snapshot camera, then I moved on to the digital camera, like my first digital SLR camera. And I didn't know how to use it, so I had to learn. And I took some workshops at the Santa Fe photography workshop. But my purpose there was more to learn about photographing people, because I think I'm not the most comfortable photographing people. And I was much more, and I am still much more comfortable photographing nature.
So going back a little bit, it's super interesting and fascinating to hear that art entered your life as a way of therapy and meditation, if you would call that. So do you make art for yourself? And to this day, like, do you make art for yourself or for an audience or an appreciator of your art?
I think I first started photography as self-therapy so that I can take more images of photographs of nature, because just being in nature was very calming and therapeutic. And photographing those images, it analyzes these memories, and they prolong the sense of peace, the calm that I felt when I was surrounded by nature. So for me, these short trips, so I started working in Japan in 2010. And the reason for that is so that I can travel to Hokkaido more frequently and maybe meet over there on weekends or whenever I can. It's just much more accessible, like 1 hour away from Tokyo. And I was still working in investment banking then. So these trips to me were extremely precious because of time I had for myself and also the time to spend in the place I liked. It started as photographing for myself. And over time, I think I became less reliant, especially after I left banking to focus on photography. It was no longer a stress reliever since I can photograph. Since I was not like working in an investment bank and did not have the stresses of work per se, I was teaching business English, and that the requirements on me mentally were different. And I thought I was giving back to society from like giving more back. Of course, in investment banking, we were helping out with clients, but I felt it was a different type of giving without the stress perhaps. And so the relationship between me and photography started evolving without me really being aware of it. It was only in retrospect that I realized, okay, that was when it started evolving. But because I was less reliant on it as a stress reliever, as therapy, I think I began to enjoy being in nature and enjoy photographing more. And there's something, I always thought that these photographs, when I show it to my friends, they seem to enjoy it. I think for two reasons. One, they see a different type of world. They see scenes that they have not been able to witness before. That's one. And number two, I think some find a therapeutic element in it too. So I realized that it's not just for me, but also for my friends, as well as the audience whom I show these images to. So it is my hope that both my audience, that my audience can find that sense of calm, that peace that I felt when I was photographing these images. I think it started off as something for myself. I think it's still something for myself, but with the hope, with a side hope that it will also resonate with people. I learned that different people would interpret the images differently because of their experiences. So some might see the image and feel happy, like just think that it's all about happiness, but some might actually see the same image and think it's about sadness or loneliness. So I think the interpretation is very dependent on the person and their experiences. But I just hope that it would resonate with them somehow and that they would find these images healing in one way or another.
It's really fascinating also to see that the works, your series of work, Rememberance is very personal. Like it mm-hmm. talks about your own trauma from like sadness of losing your mom and also Metamorphosis, which talks about your decision and leaving banking and moving, devoting yourself to art more completely. So yeah, it's definitely really interesting to see that connection between your personal stories, your narratives, and a more kind of general emotion, that connection with the audience.
I think I realized that I, Metamorphosis was the first project that I worked on. I chose that name because it was about the changing seasons that I love so much in Hokkaido, but as well as the changes in me that I've observed over time. It was 10 years when I started photographing in that place. So for me, I think my projects are named, or I have the stages or the it reflects the frame of mind that I am in or that I have or had. So Metamorphosis is about the possibility of change. To me, it's hopeful because it's actually possible to change. at least in some way. I think I know there is a saying that, you know, it's impossible to change, but I think it's very difficult, but at least some parts are possible if we really commit to it and allow ourselves that freedom, that possibility, and also to forgive ourselves for being one way and being willing to see that perhaps another way might be better. Rememberance, yes, it's very personal. It was more about, it's realizing that by suppressing my memories of my mother, the sadness, I was losing the memories of her as well, because I was not thinking about her. When you do not think about something, you start to forget, and or the memories become thinner and thinner. They fade. And so it's just remembering, celebrating her life, actually. And I know she loved flowers. I know that she would have loved to come more often to Japan to visit, especially during the spring season where the cherry blossoms are blooming. There is a third project, which is called Adrift, and it's about celebrating the people around us, people who are still alive. I think in our, or at least in my attempt to, or in my situation, I realized that I was so hung up on my mother that I probably forgot to devote enough attention and time to my father and my brother and sister. Although the projects are about me, but I was much older than my brother and sister, 7 and 9 years older than they are, than they were when I lost my mother, when we lost our mother. So I think if it was difficult for me, I imagine it was much more difficult for them. And I did not have the capacity at that time to think about that. it was at the back of my mind, but I don't think I had, I did not have the capacity to pay too much attention to the things that were happening around me, which is why I said that at Lik Nam So, at Tibet, where the change happened, it was realizing that the world, life is much bigger than I am. And it was that realization. But the project only came about much later. And it started drift. It's about me being lost and then found. And I just wanted to make sure that, and I'm thankful that it's not too late to celebrate or to celebrate the people who are still alive around me, and that's family and friends, and who have put up with me and supported me throughout my years of, throughout my challenging years, or throughout the years when I was very difficult to deal with.
Yeah, it's definitely fascinating to see the kind of life and death as your series of motifs, because metamorphosis is also about like a rebirth, whereas remembrance, you are kind of tracing death with a drift. You are treasuring the living ones around you. It's definitely super interesting to see that motif being part of your work.
And perhaps it doesn't go too far away from death. I think it's realizing that that there is mortality, that life is, there is a finite number of years. My mom passed away at 50, and I'm not too far away from age 50. So, and my dad is getting old. And so I think, like I said, I'm just glad it's not too late to remember the people around me, to celebrate the people around me. I think life is very unpredictable. I think with COVID-19, that has brought it closer home. I'm fortunate that I may not have very close friends who have passed away from COVID-19, but even the past 2 years, there were some friends who have passed away. Like uncles or people of the same age. So I think it brings it close to home. And approaching the age when my mom passed away is a reminder, or is a constant reminder that life is precious, and that we have to, and that we need to take care of, or at least to treasure the people around us.
Sorry, I cut you off.
Oh, I said sorry to interrupt.
I was just gonna say, given we're already on the topic of COVID-19, and I saw your video work, Ephemeral, is that something that relates to COVID-19? And if you want to talk a little bit about your time during COVID.
The project Adrift was like most of the images were taken during COVID-19. The video Ephemeral, I think there are two videos. Yeah, Ephemeral was right when COVID-19 started. I think at that time I still did not have a sense of what it really was. I didn't think it would last that long. I thought maybe like 3 months, and then it just went on. But Ephemeral, it was still when it just started, the video that was taken. So it hasn't really struck me yet. But when I moved on to spring, and then later on to summer, but especially spring, Japan was in a state of emergency, its first strict lockdown. And so gyms were closed, department stores were closed. Most of my clients, my students who are bankers at where I used to work, Citigroup in Japan, as well as some other banks, they had to stop working at the office. And so I couldn't teach as well for some time. And because everyone thought it's not going to last for too long and that things would get back to normal, or at least we thought at that time. So lessons stopped because I think there was still value attached to face-to-face sessions rather than online and Zoom. It was only when people realized that this is here to stay that everything started moving online, in Japan at least. I think in Japan, there is still much value placed on face-to-face interactions. And a lot of the, and perhaps expressed, but then everything started moving online. And so it was in spring, in May, that I found myself stuck in Hokkaido. And that's when I spent a lot of time photographing. And there was a lot of uncertainty as well.
I'm sorry, Xuan, you got cut off. You froze for about 30 seconds.
Okay. So let me start with when everything went online and I was stuck in Hokkaido. Actually, I was fortunate to be stuck in Hokkaido for about a month. That's when I photographed a lot. And I think that's when things started sinking in that COVID-19 is really here to stay, and that working from home, doing Zoom calls, teaching online is the new norm. Even realizing that there was not that much work on the English lessons side, so I had a lot of time to photograph. And I think the images might reflect that. The theme was like fog. and I was constantly looking for fog, and it happened to be a very, very foggy spring. And so I felt that everything seemed to fall into place. Yeah. It's the uncertainty. I felt that was, so in terms of what I was seeing and how I felt, it was aligned, and it was very interesting that way.
And I also think it's fascinating to draw this connection between landscape and figure, and you don't have figuration in your works, but it is about people, it's about you, your relationship, your encounter, and how can you talk about how, like, what feeds your art, what goes into your creative process?
Photographing people is difficult. I have seen my mentor, my photography mentor, and photograph people, and she's just so natural when she interacted with them. I remember my first trip with her was to Guizhou in China. She doesn't speak Mandarin, I speak Mandarin, but she was so much better at interacting with them than I was. And so I think it's, I'm not sure why, but I think it's my character. So I'm not the type that, I'm not the type that gets comfortable with people easily. So I might appear to do so when I'm with clients, but there is a mission there, right? There is an objective when I'm dealing with clients. So I find myself just diving in those situations. But when I'm on my own, I find it very difficult to get close. I think striking up a conversation is possible, but getting close, that emotionally close, is difficult. And so people photography for me is extremely difficult. I don't think I'm able to capture their essence, their spirit, as some other photographers can do so. Nature photography or landscape photography resonates with me Maybe because the nature, because nature and landscapes themselves resonate with me. So I find myself in sync with nature, with landscapes. And I'm like, this is so beautiful. Wow. Oh, I love this. I need to photograph this. And coming back to your earlier point on ephemeral, I think there is something about, and I think it applies to people as well, like the smiles, for example, that emotion, that facial expression, they are all fleeting. So you have to capture that. I think for me, I'm capturing the expressions, the fleeting expressions of nature and landscape. And for me, it's just easier to do it with landscape and nature. I find myself less hesitant and perhaps less aware of the interactions around me when I'm photographing nature and landscapes.
And you mentioned Tibet being one of the, and Hokkaido being one of the destinations where you go for shots. Can you talk a little bit about how you travel to these places and what kind of selection processes, and during your creative process, what are your kind of mental state like? Like what kind of music do you listen to? What do you like to do? What are some of the smaller habits, just to take us kind of into your studio space?
Right. So on the selection of places, Tibet, I've actually not been back to Tibet since. Although the landscape was beautiful, I think for me it was more difficult to go back in terms of accessibility. Hokkaido is just much more convenient for me. But there's another reason why Hokkaido resonates with me. And that is, I think when I was younger, my dad would try to take the family away at least once a year for a trip during our school holidays. And I think I was about 9 or 10 when we first went to Hokkaido as a family. And it was during winter. And there was something very peaceful about it. I had to bring my holiday homework. Singapore is big on holiday homework. So I had to bring like my schoolwork there. But even then, it was a great break. Like even if it's like 4 or 5 days, I was really happy. So I think it's that childhood memory, the simplicity of life then. It's just like homework and fun and play. And my family was intact. My mother was there. My brother was born, was a couple of years old, and my sister was just born. And so it was just very nice memories, childhood memories. I think it's just the simplicity. So that state was me. And when I started working in Hong Kong after leaving the IMF, I find myself being drawn back to Japan when I had time to travel. So, and every opportunity I had to take vacation, I would actually go to Hokkaido or to Japan. And so I think it's, again, it's that draw. Perhaps it was, I think unconscious perhaps, but that draw of Hokkaido, that that safe place, that safe spot. So I find myself going back there. And Hokkaido is beautiful, it's simple, the people are simple. Most of them are farmers in other seasons, and in winters they are ski coaches or they help out at the ski resorts and hotels. The people are really lovely there. So when I started working in Japan, I had more time to travel there. And one of the farmers I met, he was also a ski coach. He suggested that I visit during other seasons. And that's my first visit. My first visit was during spring. And then I went, oh, this is beautiful. So that's what started my frequent trips to Hokkaido. And that was like 10, 11 years ago. And it was I think it's more a choice that started when I was a child. And because it's so comforting being there, I just kept wanting to go back. And because there is abundant nature, snow, the four seasons, it's great for landscapes. For other trips, I think after being in Hokkaido for a while, I decided that I needed to pull myself away from Hokkaido and start exploring other parts of Japan, especially after I left banking. So I went to Shiretoko and then I started going to Nagano. Shiretoko is in Hokkaido as well. It's in the eastern tip of Hokkaido, where you can see whales and the seafood is great, and you can go see bears, I think the black bear, on guided tour trips. It's a bit far from Tokyo, and so I first went there after I left banking, when I had more time. And then other places like Nagano, which is beautiful for its cherry blossoms, and Aomori. So these are some places that I started exploring over the last 2-3 years. As to trips overseas, I know that I take refuge in landscapes, that I am much more comfortable in landscapes than with people. I recognize that, and I thought it's important to not forget to stay in touch with the world around me. So my photography mentor, Nevada Weir, conducts trips to places like India, Sri Lanka, South Africa, to both exotic, to quite exotic places from my perspective. And I thought it was important to go on some of these trips so that I stay in touch with the rest of the world. I think reading about places on the web or in books is a bit different from actually going to the places themselves and to see and to meet the people there. So, but on those trips, I would photograph people and I would do some landscapes as well, like when we went to Bhutan. The purpose of those trips is more for getting in touch with people, staying in touch with people and learning about a different culture and about a different place. But not to lose my humanity while trying to escape from it.
Yeah, that's fascinating. And can you also talk a little bit about the studio processes? Do you edit your photos afterwards? And how do you work? Like, how does that mental space work?
Right. I do edit my images on Photoshop. When I started my mentorship with Nevada, after I left banking, I decided I need a proper mentor. So through the Santa Fe Photographic Workshops, I got a mentorship with Nevada. I first met her in, I think it was 2010, when I took a workshop. And I thought that if I ever leave banking and focus on photography, I would meet her regularly. And that's how it started. I think our mentorship started in, I can't remember, 2004 maybe, and it lasts, and I met her quite consistently over the course of 3 years. I think each mentorship program was about 16 sessions each. So I think, no, sorry, more than 3 years, 4 or 5 years. And one thing that she pointed out was that my images, that I need to work on my images, as in process my images, because they were not, they were a bit too bland. The reason for processing the images is the camera is unable to capture what the eye is able to capture. So the vibrant colors that I saw with my own eyes are not accurately reflected by the camera. So in order to make it as close to what I saw, I needed to work on it in like on Photoshop or in Lightroom, which is another Adobe software. So that's equivalent to working in the dark room for digital file, sorry, for film. So I do have to process them, but I'm not very good at it. So I get help from Mark Olbert. He is who I call the guru for Photoshop. I took a course with him at the Santa Fe Photography Workshops again, as well. I think that's like my school. and that workshop was where I learned how to print. And I realized that in order to print, I need to process my images too, because the print comes out a bit differently. So I'm still getting guidance, I'm still learning and having fun processing my work and getting Mac to help. In a way, he's like my sounding board. So I do seek his opinion on like, oh, does this image look better than that image? What do you think? So it's nice to have someone to speak to and to take a look at my work without the emotional baggage I had. I think one thing about photography is we need to edit our work. So we might take like 10, in my case, like 10,000 images. So I would do like the first round of edit and winnow it down to maybe like 100 images. Now I try to cut it down again. And over time, I do find that I fall out of love with some of my images. So I might end up with about like 60 images, but there are some repetitions. So it's important to have, if I'm unable to edit it objectively, I would need to get someone else to help me look through it and say, oh, this doesn't work. One thing which Nevada taught me was that I had to put aside the emotional attachment I had to the image. For example, it was like freezing cold. It was very difficult to take that image, but it shouldn't affect how I judge the image. And so spending time away from the image helps because we perhaps forget the hardship of the trip or like, oh, it was so exciting. And so the emotional element kind of subsides over time. But at the same time, if I can't pick, I need a certain set of opinion. I need an independent and someone whom I can trust to tell me why this image works or why that image doesn't work. So I'm still looking for guidance constantly.
And you were making photography works only pre-2020. In past 2020, you had video works. Is that the first time you started working on this video media?
Yeah, I think I started taking clips and like video clips, but I would actually say it's the technology, the advancement of technology. So the cameras are getting better and better, and the video quality is getting higher and higher too. And I started off with a Canon camera, but I found that there was some issues. Maybe it was just the way I used it or my ignorance of using, like with respect to using it. But I switched to a Lumix camera because it could take the transition between video and images became is much easier. And I think that was also a realization when I was photographing images like fog or the Diamond Death, that it's actually difficult to imagine how it looks like. So it gives that one, the photographs to me are capturing that moment, but it gives a different feel to the audience, I think, or gives a different experience to the audience when they see the video. They would actually see the diamond dust moving. And I think that is not, the essence of the diamond dust is not fully captured by still images. And so I thought the video would do it better justice. And that was the reason for starting on video. And once I started that, I thought, oh, the same applies to fog. We actually don't see the fog moving, or we don't see the water moving. So I thought, oh, maybe I should photograph that too. take a video of that too, or rain. We don't really see the rain. And so that's the reason for creating these videos. Mm-hmm. So partly due to technology and partly due to what nature presented to me. And there was a piece of music. I used music by Luca Longobardi for these video clips. And I realized I didn't answer your question on what I listen to, what inspires me. Luca Longobardi is a composer, an Italian composer, and he has allowed me to use his music. My mind gets really busy when I, every day. So in order to calm my mind down when I photograph, I listen to music. His music especially calms me down. And so I am listening to his music while I photograph. And I thought that I could replicate that experience for my audience by accompanying the video with music. And I feel that just a video on its own, for me at least, is a bit boring. So I thought having the music would breathe life into the video. And I feel that Luca's music does that for my videos. And he has very, very kindly allowed me to use his music with the video. So I need to give a shout out to him.
Yeah, that's amazing. You're collaborating with other artists as well in other genres. And I'm thinking, although I know artists doesn't enjoy being labeled, but to kind of associate it with different kind of movements or understanding for the audience, would you like kind of recognize your art to go with anything such as like the feminist art movement or any genre?
I was told to go and study art history, but that's not. No, I'm not sure what movement it would fall into. I've not come across the category, but there is, someone did suggest something. You would need to give me a moment to look it up. I did buy the book. Hang on, can you give me one moment? So I think I was advised to, I'm not saying that my work fall into this category, but I was advised to take a look at pictorialism. And this is a set of images where I think I had went through some portfolio reviews last year, and actually two of the reviewers suggested that I look up books on pictorialism. And because that was when the artist, it's like photograph as art or photograph as painting. I think if there is a category if there is something, my objective or what I'm trying to do, I get very excited when someone tells me that my photograph looks like a painting. To me, that's a huge compliment. or that it looks like a watercolor print. And I go like, really? Yes. So I'll be so excited when someone tells me that. And I think that comes back to my first influences, Monet, Renard, Degas, Chagall, and because I first fell in love with art when I saw their work. And so maybe that stuck with me. And whenever I need inspiration, I would actually look at art. And recently I fell in love with another painter. Can I bring it here? One moment. Three of his books. It's a Chinese painter who is still alive. And his name is Li Huayi. So L-I-H-U-A-Y, H-U-A and then Y-I. So he paints landscape. And I've seen some of his work and installations and they look beautiful. It's like Chinese watercolor, but it's modern painting. So I hope to go in that direction. And perhaps that's the reason for the fog, which is something more mysterious. And right now, I think a month ago, early June, I started looking more into water, like rushing water. So that's the direction that I'm heading towards. But if there's a genre, I think trying to approximate my, trying to give that painterly feel, is that what I would describe my work? And to me, I'm really happy when they can't really differentiate. Or is that a painting or is that a a photograph? So that to me, it's exciting.
Yeah, it's fascinating the relationship between photography and paintings. And when you were talking about the fleeting moments that you were so like inspired by impressionism, that definitely like draws the connection. I mean, for me, right there, yeah.
I think it's a limitation, and I'm not sure if fellow photographers would be upset at me for saying that, but I think that I remember I saw. Oh, sorry, there was another photographer that I love. And his name is Goto Sumio, a Japanese painter who has a gallery in Hokkaido, actually in Kamifurano, which is the place that I go very often. And then whenever I'm stuck, I would go visit his gallery and see his painting for inspiration. And he has this painting where it was sunny on the left. Actually, he was painting in China. It's sunny, not sunny. It was raining on the right. And then it was, the rain has stopped as you move towards the left. And then it's sunny after the rain. So I think that's extremely beautiful and creative. I'm not sure if that's something that I can ever do in real life, landscape image where I have both sun and rain. I think it's possible, right? But I'm looking for that moment where I can combine both. But that's one limitation I feel. There are certain things that I can't paint in, but hopefully, but I think nature is so amazing. So it's always presenting me surprises that I can capture.
Yeah, it's interesting how like, with photography, you can almost paint with like technology, like Photoshop. It's a different of paintbrush.
Yeah, you can swap heads and like enlarge people's muscles, make them thinner.
Yeah, social media power.
But I was warned, not warned, but I was advised by my mentor not to step over that line for my photography, at least, because I think because it might confuse the audience, or once the audience look at the image, they're going to start wondering, was that a composite image, which is like two or three images blended together, or was it the real thing that I saw with my eyes? That was actually one of the reasons why I made the video as well. It is to show people that this exists, that the diamond dust exists. Because when a lot of people look at the image, they think it was superimposed onto nature, that the bubbles were not real and that I had actually made a composite, superimposed two images to create that effect. But it's not. It's something that nature presented me, it was like gave me a present. But I think a lot of people who have not seen such an amazing phenomena would not be able to imagine that to be true. That said, I know that CGI and everything, it's so big now. So even creating that video, if the video is not evidence that it exists, it could just be CGI. I could be thought of as CGI. So I was a bit bummed. So technology advancement has its positive and negative. It just means that it's maybe harder for people to believe that such amazing natural phenomenon like diamond dust exists. So it's a stretch of the imagination, I think.
That's fascinating. And also I want to kind of cover your whole spectrum of creativity. Could you tell us a little bit more about your earlier works and any kind of upcoming future works, any kind of future 5 to 10 years plan or any next series that you're planning on?
Yes, the next series I'm planning on, actually, let me start from the beginning. So metamorphosis, when I look through my older photographs, I do realize that they are more like straight shots of landscapes. So, and that the images that remained with me were a bit more mysterious. So were less defined. So you might not be able to see that tree over the tree. You might see the tree and say, oh, what's the rest? So there is more, it's more open to interpretation, I think, the later images or the more successful images. And it's the more successful images from the past 10 years that stayed was me. And it, in a way it forms the, it gives me an indication of where I should head to it because these are the ones that I still love even after 10 years and the others have, I've just like removed them. I think for my next set was, last year was fog. This year there was less fog, still some fog, but in a way I'm at the mercy of nature. So whatever it gives me, I photograph or when I happen to be there. So these are all chance encounters, but I do find myself like attracted and maybe looking for it, and that was what I did last year with fog. And this year, a couple of weeks ago, I traveled to Oidase. It's a gorge, it's a valley, and there is a long river by it. And that was where I managed to take a lot of long exposures of the waves of the stream. And I think that would be the next project. I have come up with a name for it, Undulations. I think it kind of reflects the current environment too, which is COVID-19, the movements, the ups and downs that we all go through emotionally, as well as what was shown by me in nature, which was the waves, the white in motion capture. So that's the direction I'm heading towards. I think maybe the next one would be, I started printing some works over the past couple of months, and they were in black and white. And I really like the impact of how it looks in black and white. Let me make a clarification here, which is I do not photograph in black and white, but the images happen to be in black and white, for example, like the mountains and the fog, or many of them appear to be in monotones. So, and I find that it's really beautiful on paper. So maybe I would start putting together a collection or be more conscious about black and white scenes in front of me and photograph them. So I do not convert from color to black and white per se, but I think I will be on a more active lookout for black and white images. For example, snow against like trees. So that's quite black and white. They turn out more or less black and white, or like fog against shadows. And that turns out black and white too. So it would probably hit in that direction next.
And how about your earlier works? I know like sometimes it's fully, artists are a little bit protective of their,
Of their earlier works? No, yeah. My earlier works, I think now that I'm seeing things a bit differently, I think hopefully a bit more refined. So I did look through some earlier works to see if there is anything I missed, there is any image that I liked or that I didn't like, but I actually liked, or I liked and didn't like. So there are a few images, but they're not a lot. And I think they could give me some ideas for future projects. There's one image that still stays with me in my mind, and that I have kind of like dug it out recently and used it for the cover of my portfolio review. And so I do that, but there are very few images from my earlier work that I can show. and the reason is not because of that I'm not willing or that I want to hide them, but I think they were not very good. So they were not very good. Oh, I thought they were great. And then now I go, oh, they're not very good. So I think that's the reason for not showing those. There are some with potential. So I think I might photograph more of those type of images, but it might lead to a different direction. And I hope that could be an exciting idea. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm looking for ideas on how I can improve or how I can evolve. I think people might become sick if they keep seeing the same images or the same type of images. So if there is anything I'm worried about, that's whether people will get sick of it. But fortunately, I think I get sick of things quite easily. So probably I will get bored of those images before other people do. So that should be a good source of inspiration, mm-hmm. Or at least a motivator.
Yeah, that's super fascinating. And also I'm curious, does your work and your cultural heritage or your ethnicity, does they have any kind of interaction with one another?
Not yet. My work and ethnicity, I think it might influence what I like. Well, it does influence what I like. Example, like the watercolor, this artist. So, but then thinking about it, like Monet and Renoir, they are like European, like Western. So, but so I would say yes and no, but I do love watercolor paintings. And these, like the black and white, sanshikhua. So the landscape, so I really love those. And I watch a lot of TV still. And I love, and perhaps this is the cultural influence, I love watching the wuxia xiaoshuo, like the, especially the gudaiqu, which is the historical dramas, the Chinese historical dramas. And some of them are really beautiful, you know, the background and all that. And they would show mountains and people flying about with the kung fu, the martial arts. So, and I think a few years ago, I saw this movie that I really liked a lot in terms of, it was very beautiful, like image-wise, like the background and all that. The movie was okay, but so I think these are still influences on my life. And I think because I'm able to speak Japanese and Mandarin, it might be easier for me to travel about in these countries than it might be for me to, for example, travel in France. So I think it does influence my choices. For example, like now I'm living in Japan. It's easier for me to blend in as well. So it's much easier for me to blend in and hence to photograph. Because otherwise, you know, people would start like looking at me. I remember when I was in India and we were photographing people and locals would want to photograph us as well and have us in their selfies on the reefies. So it's nice, it's great for people photography as a form of interaction with the culture. But for me, when it comes to nature photography, I want to be more like alone and quiet. So being able to blend in with my environment in a way helps, definitely.
And I'm also curious, does sailing kind of have any kind of inspiration for your art?
I think sailing has a huge influence, not on my art, but on my person. I started sailing when I was really young, and I fell in love with it because of the competitions. I know a lot of people ask me, have you been sailing recently, or have you sailed since you left competition? And the answer is no. I know that it's great to be in the wind and it does link to nature, but for me, sailing was more about competition and strategizing. So the strategy aspect of it that I loved so much was probably also partly influenced by my love of historical dramas, whether it was like palace intrigue or like war and all that. So there are influences, but I think it influences me more in terms of the thinking. And also competitions, participating in those, we had to be very mentally tough and be able to handle setbacks and failures. But also when we win, once we win a competition, how do we sustain that mentality to win other competitions? So like winning one might be easy, but winning the next one and the next one. So I think it... what it does for me, and through sailing, I got to meet a sports psychologist who has had a significant influence on my life and whom I still stay in contact with and I'm eternally grateful for. He taught me to anchor, because in order to win competitions, you need to have your frame of mind in a certain, like to be a positive state. So things, like failures, past failures, or fear of failure, future failure, or expectations on ourselves that we impose on ourselves can interfere with the way we perform during competitions. So his advice is always to anchor these past failures or these distractions, as we would call it, expectations from people around us as well as from ourselves, and to focus on the task at hand. And so that advice, that mental toughness has come very handy to me throughout my entire life. And being able to handle failure, but even if you get a rejection, it's like, it's okay. When I work on something else, not to be held back by past rejections or past failures, and not to be distracted by expectation of the future or what people think I should do. And I think that's really helped me as a person. But but I think that's a huge part of the influence of sailing on my life. Mm-hmm.
It's also fascinating that your dad is also a sailor.
Yeah, he was the one who made me sail But there were like two competing forces. So my dad wanted me to fail. But my mom, being a traditional Chinese, well, although she didn't want to be traditional, she was still somewhat traditional in that she wanted me to study hard and to, she didn't really like sport. So she wanted me to dance, ballet, and play the piano. And she didn't want my skin to get dark. So she was not a fan of sailing, but my dad was. And my dad started sailing because of his exchange program to San Jose in the States, where his host family made him sail. Introduced sailing to him, and he fell in love with it. And so for me, when I started, my dad made me take a course when I was 7 years old, and I hated it, actually, at that time, because I think I was the smallest, and I was paired with this tall guy. I think he was from America, but his family was in States, and so he would have to carry me onto the boat because I couldn't climb up. So I felt very helpless. And once when the boat capsized, I was stuck under and I was like trying to gasp for air. So it was not a very good experience. I stopped for it, but my parents said they are very flexible. They are like, oh, if you want to do it, you do it. If you don't want to do it, don't do it. So, but when I was 11 years old, I went to see a competition, and it was in Thailand, in Pattaya. And they seemed to be having so much fun. So I thought, oh, okay, I'll try it. So that's what got it me started on sailing. And that was the sort of influence from my dad. But actually, and the interesting thing was, during one of the competitions, my mom, there was some issues during the competition, and I was in a very bad position. And my mom was the only one who had faith in me. She said, you can do it. I know you can win this competition. And so that surprised me, that shocked me, because I always thought that she was not supportive of me sailing. So it's interesting how incidents or challenges reveal a different side of ourselves as well as of our parents.
Yeah, that's fascinating. And also, I'm curious, since art has been very, your work is so like beautiful and tranquil and almost timeless, and it really adorns and help us admire nature. I'm also wondering, at the same time, is there anything that you try to use art as a language or through art to kind of protest against or confront? Is there anything that you're trying to kind of to speak through art as a way to rebel against? Does that seem to be part of your art language at any point?
I do feel that art is transcends language borders. I think recently I think it does. When we look at a piece of art, for example, like of Di Huayi, even if we don't speak his language, Mandarin, we can understand. And I know Chagall, his art, there was meaning to it. For me, rather than protesting or a statement against something, I think for me, art and nature is more a route of escape. So I think when I communicate with my friends, especially when I read news, like whether it's COVID, whether it's about inequality, or whether it's about discrimination, I I do. I find myself getting very angry, right? And or very, very sad. I did read about like Asians being beaten up. I've seen videos because of COVID-19. I do follow like George Floyd and the protests in the States, and like in Asia as well. We do read about like Myanmar and all that. And some of these places are places that I've been to. So I do feel intensely about it. But I think for me, my photographs are to allow me to escape from these unhappiness, these injustices that I see in life. So I wish that they can be a statement, but to be honest, I'm not sure how that they can serve as a statement of protest. With respect to the environment, I did think about it, if it could be a statement of, for example, against global warming, or can it be about against like deforestation or like preserving our environment? Could there be meaning behind it? But I find it, I'm not sure if I can, if I can do that. In that I know a lot of photographers, when they photograph, it's with that mission in mind, with that objective in mind that they go photograph. So it influences their work while they are photographing or before they photograph. For me, I'm afraid it's only going to be after the fact. So I'm not sure if it would be considered genuine. And that's my very honest opinion, or I should say confession to you. I think art has always been a form of escape for me. So, which is why after reading all these news, I'm always very happy when I'm photographing, because it gives me a breather. But then I know that I have to stay in touch with all these news, both for my work, as well as because I'm a human being. And so there is this like puzzle between the sadness and the anger at the injustices, but at the same time trying to maintain a distance and hiding behind my art. So yeah, in a way I'm still hiding or taking a breather, to put it in a better way, from what's happening.
Yeah, thank you for your honesty and sharing.
I think just one more point, which is, I think, or I hope that that with, not sure what I wanted to say, but I think I hope that it's somewhat connected to the previous point, which is, I think we need to find a balance in life. I think sometimes there is a lot of anger, especially in social media. And when like one emotion builds on another and another emotion builds on the other. And sometimes, you know, people can be quite mean or cruel when they are writing without too much, or in their actions as well, without too much thinking about the consequences on the people whom they hurt, as well as the future impact. I think sometimes we are just caught up in the moment and perhaps trying to release that emotion or that anger that they feel, that fear that they feel when they see perhaps an Asian walking on the street and linking it with the pandemic. I think that it's always good to have a different type of outlet rather than through words, which can lead to suicides in Japan as well, when especially last year, I think there were quite a few cases where attacks on social media led to the loss of lives and like the actual physical attack. I hope that we can all find a different outlet and hopefully like art can be that, whether we are channeling our energy, negative energy in a different way. So I hope that the images can provide, I know that art is a luxury good and they might not make any sense or, you know, people might just think that it's only for people who have time. But I hope at least it can provide people with a sense of serenity, I hope. At least that's my far out hope that these images can be useful in one way or another. They do not record the injustices or what's happening to our forests or like the fires, but I hope it can provide a different type of use. Yeah. Sometimes I do reflect and I think like, oh, what's the purpose of my images? Do they serve a greater purpose? Do they make any sense? Are they helping anyone in any way? And to be honest, I don't really think so. But I hope that in time to come that it may be useful in one way or another.
Yeah, definitely.
It's rambling.
Not at all. Thank you so much. For that's a really beautiful, beautiful wish for mankind for the future. I will also love to talk about your like teaching in Japanese languages.
Oh, yeah. Sure. I teach Japanese bankers English, but having a knowledge of Japanese really helps. Or being aware of some of the standard issues. For example, in Japan, pronunciation-wise, because of the alphabet construction, the A is always the A sound. The A is always the A sound. But in English, for example, we have A, we have N, and then we have different sounds for A. But because of the way it's being taught here, for example, management becomes management, right? So the pronunciation is different. And so being aware of knowing Japanese and being aware of some of these cultural as well as language construction differences really help. And I think teaching is good for my soul. So, I think being able to help someone improve is great. And I think I also learn a lot by seeing how someone learns and how someone progresses. And so it's been actually quite fun and I think meaningful as well. So it sets me in a better mind frame for photography, I think, as well. So that's good for me as a person and my character.
That's fascinating. You're multifacetious and photography, arts, and sailing, and now like language teacher. I wonder how to balance all these different roles in your life.
I was told by someone that having different experiences and having different interests help with photography. So I do hope it's true.
Yeah, that's fascinating to hear about your story with Japanese language. And can you also talk about how Chinese language has impacted your kind of thinking processes?
Yeah, I think Chinese language, so both Mandarin and Cantonese, being able to, well, in Singapore, we studied the simplified Chinese writing. So, but because my mom and I used to watch the Hong Kong TV series a lot when I was younger. So, and she bought magazines from Hong Kong, like the gossip magazines. So I'm also familiar with the traditional Chinese because I used to read those magazines too. Not all the words, but a number of the words. And so I think being able to read these languages in this other language makes it easier for me to access, for example, like Chinese only reading materials. And that has really helped in, for example, when I look at some works by Chinese painters, so to understand in the original language what their intention or what their motivations, the inspirations were. I think I've been taking Mandarin lessons again recently. Because having been based in Japan for the past 10 years, I have had very little opportunities to speak in Mandarin. I might watch TV, but I don't have anyone to speak to. So I started doing that again. And with my Mandarin teacher, we came up with the Chinese equivalent name for the projects that I've come up with. And also when I posted about my gallery representation with Photo Relevance, I was also able to write a paragraph in Mandarin. And I find that although I haven't used it for so long, that the Mandarin language came probably the closest to expressing my emotions. Compared to with other languages. And so that was an interesting revelation for me. I was very, very surprised. I thought English would be English, which is something that I've been using most of the time, would actually do that, but it was Mandarin that managed to do it for me. So
great, thank you. Can you also talk about how you encountered Photo Relevance and established that relationship with Houston?
So I first met, I was actually in Houston last year for FotoFest. Once every 2 years festival, which connects various experts and specialists in the photography world with photographers like myself. So it was supposed to be my first portfolio review, and unfortunately, the first session went ahead, but I was signed up for the second session, so I flew over to Houston on a day when when WHO declared COVID-19 as a pandemic. And after I arrived, on the morning that it was supposed to start, the session got canceled. I had to fly back without attending my former review. But some of the reviewers were really kind and they stayed back to look at our work. So that was my first taste of a portfolio review. I was supposed to meet Jeffrey last year, but unfortunately, because the session was canceled, I didn't get to see him. During the last year, I started attending other portfolio reviews, which were all moved online. And to be honest, I was very, very thankful for this online opportunity, because because I would not have been able to attend all these portfolio reviews time-wise, because I do have a job here, and also expenses. It's going to be very expensive to fly over each time and then pay for lodgings, accommodation, and all that. So the bright side of the pandemic for me was the opportunity to attend these reviews online. And I really hate to say that, it's the bright side. But this year, FotoFest decided to hold the postponed session in March this year for for those of us who missed last year. And so I finally got to meet Jeffrey this year through PhotoFest. And he looked at my work and he suggested that we speak after the portfolio review. And that's what started the relationship. Bryn Larson, who is the other co-owner, actually saw my work before Jeffrey did. And she saw my work on an online magazine, a photography magazine run by Eileen Spring and Susan Ravi. They are the co-authors, they are the co-owners of What Will You Remember? So it's an online magazine. And so she saw my work there because I met Eileen at LACP, so it's the Los Angeles Center of Photography. So they held a portfolio review as well last year, towards the end of last year. So Eileen showed my image as well as images from other participants on her website, along with those whom Susan met. So that's how all the connections came through. Looking back, I think I'm thankful that I had, the flip side is I met Jeffrey and Bryn 1 year later. But I think the positive thing is I think I had much more time to get my thoughts together about photography, about and be really able to prepare for this relationship with the gallery. So I'm on the positive side, I'm thankful for the time. I don't think I was that prepared last year, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. Have you got a chance to come to Houston yourself yet?
I think later this year would be possible. So first I need to be vaccinated. Japan's rollout has been a bit slow. I have made an appointment. We have the reserve slots to be vaccinated. So hopefully everything would go smoothly and I should be able to come to Houston in November this year for the solo exhibition. So I'm really keeping my fingers crossed.
Yeah, that's fascinating. I'm sure Houston is really looking forward to seeing yourself and your work as well.
Thank you.
Would you be willing to leave a time capsule for us for the future of humanity?
Time capsule?
For example, a post-apocalyptic world. If there's an alien coming to find your time capsule, what would you like to tell them?
Right, like if they discover it 10 years or like 20 years from now, I would tell them that life is beautiful. It's a phrase that has stayed with me and it's just full of hope. And I think keeping that in mind, I think that sometimes we lose hope in humanity or in ourselves. And I think to keep in mind that life is beautiful, that it's big, and that we're just a small part of it, will really help set things in perspective, I think, for us. At least it did for me. I think it totally did for me. So I hope it would resonate with people around me too.
Well, thank you so much. That was such a treat for me to interview you and document your art history.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. I appreciate this opportunity. Thank you so much.